So what it means is that at least there exists a variety which is a finite type, which parameterizes semi-stable objects. And so how do I think this thing? I think it's as follows. Can use SER theorem, and again, I can have a surjection of the following form of C, I'm sorry, minus M, direct sum, the order characteristic of EM. And since the one is zero, with the surjection into E. So E is globally generated by some M, which is going to be something which depends only on rank and degree. Okay, so this is invariant under all objects that are semi-stable of the same fixing rank and degree. And so what I think about this, I think about this thing as an element in a fixed quark scheme, and the quark scheme somehow, yeah, I have this M, but I can change uniformly E with E minus with E of M. And so what do I get? I get something which is a quotient of black copies of the structure sheaf into E. Okay, so that's where we are. And so what did we prove? Somehow we didn't prove anything, but still, what is the idea of this thing? The idea is that we have embedded our object into a certain quad scheme. Depends on the curve, yeah. On the curve, yeah. The curve is fixed. Depends, but only on the genus of the curve, right? Only in the genus, because this is the somehow. Okay, this depends on the curve, but it's somehow the only thing I care here is the numerical win. So it's just 2g-2. Thanks. Yeah. Good. So we have an element of quad scheme, and so what we do now? Okay, now is where JIT comes, and as I said, we are not going to use it anymore. So let me just do it in one blackboard. So I'm looking at the following subset inside the quad scheme. So the quad scheme parameterizing such a quotient in which I fix rank and degree, of course. And this is fixed by, I look at the subset, let me just make it briefly this part, of quotients of the form O direct sum chi of V, and I call them U. And these U have the following properties. So I want U to be locally free. And I want the section of O direct sum chi of V to be the same as the section of U. Okay, so that's what I want. And now, so here is the statement, and that's where the property of smoothness comes, and integrality, that the issue is that this guy is smooth. But this is only for curves. And is integral. So the smoothness is not so hard. That's just standard deformation theory using this condition. Integrality is also not so hard because essentially you can write everything as some sort of, you can dominate with some map which is given by extensions somehow. So that's not so hard. And now what is the last thing? The last thing you can somehow, this object E is not really uniquely determined, but is uniquely determined up to an action of PGL. And so this is what I want to do. So it's both an integral and PGL chi of V acts on it. So it acts by just changing some of the presentation here. Okay. And so what I want to do, I want to do the following thing. I take M, my MG RD, and I would like to say that this guy is the quotient of my quad scheme, my subset of the quad scheme, modulo PGL key. And for doing this quotient, I need what Radu was talking last week, which is the notion of stability with respect to GIT. And the interesting fact here, the two stability coincide. So that's actually how the definition of stability came into picture, because it comes directly from here. So R semi-stable points, in the sense of GIT, they coincide with semi-stable sheaves, vector bundles, in our definition. Okay, and of course, stable correspond to stable. Okay, so our definition of numerical definition of stability is equivalent to the definition of semi-stability coming from JIT that you saw last week. And so the correct notion is that I have R semi-stable modulo PGL. Okay, so that's the way to construct this space. And then there are all the other properties. Non-emptiness is not so hard. It's coming from essentially dimension counting in this sense. And the Picard group is slightly more complicated, but we're going to talk a bit later, so maybe I'll skip for the moment. Okay, so that's all I wanted to say about stability on curves. Okay, so that should be where the class of yesterday stopped. Okay, yes.
In that case,
sure.
In our case, yeah. One of the blackboard on our left. Yeah, why the condition that the global section. You are considering R.
Yeah.
With the property.
That are quotients, right? So this is a quote scheme with these two conditions, actually.
Yeah.
So the second condition is coming here is directly from what I essentially proved. So the H1 is going to be 0, right? And so the other characteristic is going to be the H0v.
Okay.
Yeah, so that's why it's coming from. Yeah, and so here a priori I don't have it anymore, but I impose it. Okay, so this is an open condition in any case. So.
But isn't it automatic?
I don't think so.
You made a choice, right?
For our ease, yes, but in general, somehow for any quotient, somehow a priori, somehow of this subset, I just have a random quotient which have this property. So this is not automatic, right?
It's not numerical.
It's not, no. That's, yeah. So, no, sorry, numerical. For our ease, yes, But in general, somehow a priori could be larger, right, H0. But just in this condition. Yeah. But for us, you're right, it's purely numerical, of course, yeah, because it's for our E, it's just a small argument we said what we did before. So in this case, H1 is 0, so it's purely numerical. Yeah. More questions? Yes?
Condition on H0, is it related with the correspondence between semi-stability?
Yes, my objects that I have here, they will live inside here, right? And then, okay, yeah, that this is related to the fact that I want this semi-stability condition. Yes, of course, yeah.
What do you know about RSS? Is it connected?
Yeah, it's integral. R is integral. Yeah. I think I state it here somewhere. Here. yeah, but only for curves. But yeah. So that's probably, only this piece for curves. Okay, so so other question I have here? Okay, good. Then let's start with the next part. Okay, so let me just say briefly where we are here. So this is I'm not going to use these anymore, at least the JIT, because the notion of stability I'm going to define, and but in general, somehow there is no interpretation as real JIT stability. But so let me just make a small last section, which was like equivalent definitions of stability. So I have a few of them. Some of them I didn't introduce, but I won't introduce. But let me just say briefly. So there is one which is the slope definition. So this is the numerical definition we gave. This is the second one is one coming from JIT. And what I didn't prove is that these two are equal in this context. Okay. Then there are some other, but there is a nice differential geometry definition, which I didn't give you and I will not give you. And again, these two are equivalent. And there is a last one, which is a one coming from some. There are more actually, but anyway, there's one which is very interesting coming from Falting and Chaudhry. And again, this is actually equivalent, and this is actually a way to avoid JT. And so the idea is that, so which of them I can generalize to higher dimension. So now I want to know if I start with a variety x with dimension greater or equal than 2, I want to know what happens in these definitions. And so what happens is the following. So this guy comes with essentially two parts. So one part is just a fine definition similar to what we saw before for sheaves. And this is well known. This is the standard notion of Zopp stability. And which is a nice definition, but it has not anymore a GIT interpretation, so it's hard to construct modulized spaces here. But on the other hand, this notion of stability behaves much better for certain operation, which we're going to discuss a bit later. There is something else that I'm going to talk to you in a second. And the GIT definition is going to go into something which is the Giesecke Maruyama Simpson. Stability, and that works pretty well. They give you nice modulized spaces, but somehow I'm going to try to explain that somehow I'm still missing something, and B, by interpreting that in the black box that I left empty, we are going to say something interesting even about these modulized spaces somehow. Okay, and then these last two, I didn't talk about it, but this one has a generalization, which anyway, this is okay, and this is somehow essentially equivalent, at least in the case of stability. And this one is actually unknown at the moment. So it's unknown how to generalize this. And this might be interesting for several things. But anyway, so I don't want to talk about these two. I want to talk about the last one that I left open. And so the issue here is that what I do, I don't look anymore at sheaves. And so I change the abelian category. But I keep the same definition of stability. Okay? And so that's what we want to do. And of course, this guy is going to give us the following thing. This notion of stability is actually interesting because in a certain limit, it's going to recover the usual Giesecke stability. And in the other limit, there is some sort of wall, a chamber structure, in some of the wall will recover slope stability. Okay, so it's something in between the two, but it has a bad thing. The bad thing is that we lost sheaves. So all the argument that we use here that has to do with local things, we all lost. So this is an abelian category, it's an actual abelian category. So there are no objects. Okay, there are all objects, but not evidently. But the thing we gained, especially in dimension greater or equal than 2, is that you can vary stability. Okay? And so I'm trying to convince you that that is somehow useful to several things. One more comment. There is one thing that I'm missing, unfortunately, is that I told you some of the you don't know anymore like, that is a Giesecke stability in general. And so modulized space exists in a certain sense, but they are not anymore so nice. Okay, so far so, yes?
Just to know, by differential geometrical, you mean
that's correct, that's correct, thanks.
The Hitching correspondence,
that's correct. That's what I mean here. So here will be like Hitching correspondence. Well, here, by faulting Seychadri, I mean the following thing. I mean that you can characterize semi-stable sheaves on curves just by saying the following thing. A sheaf is semi-stable if and only if there exists another sheaf which is completely orthogonal. So this means that the home between the sheaf and the other, and the X1 between the sheaf and the other are all equal to zero. And it's somehow surprising. One direction is easy, but the other direction is not so easy, actually, to prove. But this is equivalent. And here at the moment, somehow, that will be useful actually to have, even for our stability. Because that actually gives a construction of the modulized space without using GIT, for example.
Buttons is more or less the cohomological.
Sorry? Yeah, there is a notion of cohomological stability, but it's, I'll comment later, yeah. So I would like something a bit more precise. I can tell you, yeah. That's. Okay, anyway, so, okay, now we have to do the small part. Okay, now we have to abstract a bit. So as I say, the category is really a category it's really an example of a abelian category in the full sense. So I have to give the definition in generality. And at the moment, let me give you the, so this is section 5, stability on abelian categories. And so this is general at the moment. And then I actually, to prove that this stability is going to be messy, and actually in another dimension is still unknown if they exist. But so let me start with the following. So A for me will be an abelian category. So I don't want to give the precise definition, but abelian category is generalization of coherent sheaves. So it has kernel, co-kernels, extensions, and the image is equal to the kernel of the co-kernel map. Anyway, so direct sum exists. Everything that that you imagine exists. So definition. The following thing happens. So a stability condition is what? It's exactly the same definition as before. So we have two functions now. So one I call it rank, which is not anymore the same rank. It's some rank function. Now I want to go a bit more general. I still want to keep it positive, but I'm now going into the real numbers. Okay, so this is my rank. And then I have another function, which I call it degree. And again, I want it to be slightly, I want to be able to deform. And so that's why I'm allowing to be free to go into R. And so what I want to be the same as stability for curves. So what it means the following. I will tell you later, I will need some more conditions, but we'll add in them later. So such that. So the first condition I want is that the rank and the degree are additive. So additive means that if I have an exact sequence, they add them up in the usual, somehow they behave like a usual rank and degree. And the second condition, which is the most important, is the following, is that if I take something which is a non-zero object, and I'm assuming that the rank of A is equal to zero, then on a curve, what does it mean? It means that the sheaf is torsion, and torsion sheaf, they always have positive degree. And so I want to impose this condition as well. Okay, I want strictly positive here. And then the same thing as before happens. So I can define a slope. Now it's the same thing, it's just abstract, but it's the same identical thing as before. And so slope is the same definition, so I call it M, which is nothing but degree over the rank. And somehow, since I'm also dealing with things with rank equal to zero, the right definition is the following. It's, I'm asking that, somehow I'm just adding plus infinity. If the new rank is equal to zero, and if it's non-zero is the usual definition. Okay, so it's the same definition as before, and so we have a notion of stability exactly as before. But you see, now it's general. Somehow before, somehow the motivation was coming from GIT, actually. Here there is no GIT, just an abelian category, okay, coming from somewhere that I'll tell you later. And then somehow in this generality, the only problem is that I cannot anymore conclude that Hardin-Razimov filtration exists, so I have to impose this condition. So Hardin-Razimov filtrations exist. Okay, so I impose it as a condition. So every object can be filtered, blah, 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 the same theorem. And the small remark is the following. It's not too hard to see. And actually, the same proof that we gave actually doesn't use anywhere that are coherent sheaves on a curve. And indeed, it's going through. It is more slightly more general setting at the moment. And so the remark or proposition, if you want, says the following thing, is that if you have some more assumption on your category, so for example, if A is Noetherian, so Noetherian abelian category means what you can expect. So if you have a chain of sub-objects, it must terminate. And the second condition is that if I look at the rank function, it goes into R, so I would like to have that that the image of the function rank is inside Z. Okay? So if I, or anyway, if it's discrete. If these two conditions are true, then Hardin-Razimov filtration exists. And that's the same thing as we saw. And that's the same proof as we saw. Somehow. If you just look at the same proof we did, this is exactly what happened. So, example, if I take A as coherent sheaves on a curve, and R is the usual rank, and D is the usual degree, I'm good. Okay, and that's exactly what we did before. Okay. Well, there's a small issue. So before we only look at the vector bundles. Here I'm also adding torsion sheaves, but nothing matters. Somehow they are not so super. They don't give you any problem. The problem is the following: is that if I go to higher dimension, I'm already. I assume this is more general, so I can choose rank and degree as I like, but I will not go anywhere in any case. And so the problem is that if I take the category A as coherent sheaves on X, where X now is my smooth projective over C with dimension of X greater or equal than 2, then the statement is that there are no such RD, which work. Okay, so that's give a problem, and so the generalization is not so useful at the moment, but I can do the following two things. I can consider the following. I can just, for example, I can the way to dissolve is by doing the following. I just somehow the only problem that this thing is caused by is if my object in codimension 2, so I can just cancel them out. That's one option. So example, if I take my category coherent sheaves on X, and then I mod out by the category of sheaves supported in codimension 2, okay, and I take this as my category A, then everything is fine, whatever this definition is. So just choose R as the usual rank, and the degree I choose as follows. So I'm fixing H an ample on X. And then I just define D as the usual definition. So I take n minus 1 copies of 1 and times C1. And that's the usual notion of slope stability I told you before. Usual slope stability for sheaves. OK, so that's the usual notion of slope stability. So sheaf is semi-stable if and only if the slope is of the sub which are positive. And that's good. But it doesn't give the good notion for curves. It's not really a generalization of curves. It's just like, it's just a stability. It doesn't see anything in codimension greater than 2. And so what we want to do, we want to do something else. Sure.
Can you explain again the definition?
Sure, of course, yeah.
You want to define a stability condition.
Yeah.
On
yeah. Two functions, rank and degree, which are additive on short exact sequence. So they are, somehow it means that if you have A equals to B goes to C, R of B is equal to R of A plus R of C, and so on. And they satisfy the following property. So if you have an object which is non-zero, which has rank equal to 0, then I want the degree to be strictly positive. Okay. So for example, and then the other conditions are just, so I have a notion of slope, I have a notion of stability, exactly as for curves, and I impose this condition here, which is pretty mild at the moment. Okay. So that's, although we have to worry about this, but later. And in the example of coherent sheaves in dimension greater than 2, if I take these two functions, for example, then I have an object which has rank is positive, good. If rank is 0, then degree is positive, good. But it might be it's 0 on codimension 2 objects. So there are objects which are non-zero, but whose rank and D are both equal to 0. If I cut them out, it's good, but anyway. OK, so what I do now, next. I'll change and go into the right category. So the idea now is that instead of asking, I want a category which is naturally associated with a variety, of course. And so how do I do? Instead of taking coherent sheaves, I'm just slightly extend them into the bounded derived category of coherent sheaves, which I'm going to define briefly, soonish. And so now the issue is, I will tell you in a second, but coherent sheaves actually do live inside the DB coex. So this is a derived category, and coherent sheaves, they are actually inside, and they generate the category. And so the idea is the following. So from here to here, I don't lose any numerics. But the only thing I do instead, I change the category. So for example, I just go here, and derived is derived category as the derived category of another abelian category. And then I will take this A inside DBA, and that will be my choice. Okay, so somehow I'm doing the following. So query sheet doesn't work. I embed into the derived category. I write the derived category as DB of another category. And then this abelian category I take here, for some sort of miracle, is going to work somehow. Okay, so that's, but it's not so easy to prove. And for surfaces, it's actually true, what I said. For threefold, yeah, it becomes messy. But we'll see something. Okay, and so that's the idea that I want to do. But numerically, you see, we gain something because now the numerics is really the same. So for example, for a surface, I have rank C1 and C2. These things are still here, so my slope will depend on them. So I didn't quotient anything. I just changed the category a bit. Okay, so that's what I want to do. And so let me start by saying what the derived category is. Okay, so I will not need much about the derived category in general, but I will need this notion of abelian category inside a derived category, which generates the category. So that's what I want. So let me start in general. So, okay, let's try. So I start with A in abelian category. And so the actual definition of the derived category, it's not too bad. It's just the following. So here I'm looking just at bounded cases. So the bounded derived category, what it is? So the bounded derived category on A is the following. I'm looking at bounded complexes of objects in A. And then I do something to it. So what I'm going to do, so let me just write it. So a complex is just, the following thing. So I have something. Which I call it, how do I call it? Ci minus 1. I will have some differentials. Okay? And so what I want for a condition of a complex, I want that the following thing happens. So the object Ci's are all in my abelian category I started with. So for example, sheaves. And the second condition I want is that it's bounded. So it means that for I large and small, these guys are just all 0. So Cj is equal to 0 for all j sufficiently large. Okay, both directions I want to be equal to 0. Okay. Now what's the morphism? A morphism of complexes is the following. So this is my complex C dot. And so I can give a morphism, which I call it F dot, into another complex. And the other complex, what it is? That's something di minus 1 goes into di, goes into di plus 1. So a morphism of complex, at the moment, is simply a morphism which goes component by component. And it does make commute all everything that has to commute. Okay, so this is a morphism of complexes. Now, so that's a category of complexes with the morphisms. But now I want to do something. Why? I want some of the derived category. I want to take a resolution of a sheaf, for example, and identify with my sheaf. So I need to do something. And so I definition, I'd say that the morphism of complex F dot from C dot into D dot is a quasi-isomorphism. And if the following thing happens, somehow the fact that everything commutes, I can look at the cohomology of the complex, which is defined as the kernel of D. Maybe let me put some indices here. So since it's a bit. Ah, sorry, I forgot one thing here. Yeah. Of course, D squared equal to 0. It's a complex. Sorry about that. Okay, otherwise. Okay, all good, right? Yeah, and so I want a DI modulo, the image of DI minus 1. I can define because I'm in a abelian category. And so the fact that the morphism of complexes, it means that this guy is going to induce a map in cohomology. And so it's a quasi-isomorphism, is the map is an isomorphism for all I. Okay. And so that's, for example, a sheaf and its resolution, they're quasi-isomorphic. And now what do? I formally do the following option. So I just take bounded complex with this morphism, and I formally invert all quasi-isomorphisms. Okay, so I take all quasi-isomorphisms, and I just invert formally, and then I see what morphism I come with. Okay, and so that's the derived category. Okay, I won't use so much this thing, but that's the definition. But I won't use the properties that I'm going to state now. And as I said, unfortunately, I won't prove anything about this, but it's not too hard. And so properties. And these I'm going to use them. So the first property is what I told you here. So the abelian category is always inside the bounded derived category, or in general, the derived category. And this embedding is fully faithful. So it means homes in the derived category are the same as homes in the abelian category. And what is the embedding? The embedding is what you expect. So I'm just taking an object and embedding it into the complex, which is zero everywhere except in degree zero, which is the object itself. Okay, so that's the first thing. So the first statement is that this map is fully faithful and the functor. First map. Second thing, there exists a shift. And the shift is actually pretty simple. What does it do? You take a complex and you shift it on the left by one. So this is a shift which I call a shift by one. I can iterate, which goes from DBA into itself. It's an equivalence. And to every complex C dot, I'm mapping into the complex C shifted by one dot, which has the following property, is that C1i is just a C of I plus 1. Okay, so it's shifted on the left. Okay, and so that's one operation. And the key property is the following, is that by using this shift, I can reinterpret usual x in the abelian category under some assumption, which maybe I'll skip for the moment, which are true for sure in coherent shifts, that what I get from this thing is the following, is that the homes in DBA between an object A and B shifted by I is going to be equal, or better, naturally isomorphic, to the X group in my abelian category, where A and B are objects inside the abelian category A. Okay, so the shift, the homes between a complex and the complex shifted by I, where the complex is just a complex support in degree zero, are the same as the X in the abelian category under some assumptions, okay? Which are okay for sheaves. Good. In particular, I want the following thing to happen. Somehow, the X is well known. They are zero for the negative X are zero by definition here. So by this argument, this guy are equal to zero if I is negative, okay? And this we're going to use it later. Okay, so there are no negative homes between objects in the abelian category. Last thing, which is the most annoying. So, and we are done after that. So there is a notion of triangle. So I lost the idea that A is in abelian category. This guy is not abelian anymore, but still there is a structure behind. And the structure is a structure of triangle. So how do I find a triangle? Let me start from the basic definition. So I start with A dot and B dot complexes. And I take a map of complexes. So this is a map of complexes. It's not something funny at the moment. Somehow it's just a map of complexes from A to B. So something which commutes with the differentials, which is an actual map. And so what I do, I can form a new complex, which is the cone. And so what is the cone? The cone has, I have to give you two things. I have to give you what is the cone in degree I. And the cone in degree I is nothing but AI plus 1, direct sum BI. And the differential of the cone is now going to be a matrix, because it's going to this thing, and it's going to do the thing that you expect. So on the diagonal, it's just going to go from A to A to B to B. But in the non-diagonal terms, I want to correct by f. Up to a sign. Okay? So this is a cone, and this guy comes directly with two morphisms. One is going into I plus 1, and one is coming from BI. And so I can write these in the diagram. So the diagram is the following. I write A dot. I write my map F B dot. And then the next one is just this map here. Let me call it G, which goes into from B dot into the cone. And this is G. And the next one is the map, which I call it H, which goes into A, but with a shift. Okay? And the definition is that this guy is called a triangle. And the second definition is that, in general, a triangle or an exact triangle, I will skip the word exact, is a diagram as before. So it's just now A goes to B, goes to C, goes to A shifted by 1, where all these guys are relevant in my derived category, and this diagram, which is quasi-isomorphic to the diagram here. So it's a bad definition, but it's I'll give you some examples that will. So somehow, this is a sort of, it's not too bad. But somehow, the fact is how to describe in general. That's not so easy, because here I don't have any more morphism of complexes. But I just call the diagram of this form an exact triangle if it's quasi-isomorphic to this guy here. As a diagram, right? So respecting everything. OK? So examples. Let me give you two examples, which are the thing we are going to use. So the first example is the following. And then I'm done with the definition of the right category. And then we finally go to what we need. So example number one. And this is important. If I have an exact sequence in A, this corresponds to, so let me call star an exact sequence. Oh, star, I use it there. Plus. An exact sequence in A, so this is an abelian category, then I can form a triangle as follows. So this is F, this is G. So I can form a triangle just by taking F goes to B, goes to G into C, and then I have to give a morphism into A shifted by 1, which I call it delta. And this is going to be a triangle, and so the only thing I have to tell you is what is delta. But delta is not so bad, because I have this property there. So what I have, delta, what it is a HOM between C and A shifted by 1 in the derived category. And so what is a HOM here? What we know by, hopefully still there, yes, is the next 1 in the abelian category between C and A. But by elementary homological algebra, an exact sequence is going to give you an extension here. This is my delta. Okay, so that's is the extension corresponding to the exact sequence. Okay, so that's one thing. The interesting thing is the vice versa is also true. So it means the following thing. So let me just say that this is also true. Sorry. Plus, thanks. Thanks. So the vice versa is also true. So it means that if I start with a triangle, all of whose elements are in A, then this comes from a unique exact sequence. So exact sequence corresponds to triangles, all of whose vertices are in the category. Good. Second thing, last thing, actually. Really last. And finally, I can abstract these properties. So another example of triangles is the following. So how does it go? So if I have If I have a complex, I call it C dot. So what I can do the following thing. So a complex is just an extension, in some sense, of its cohomology objects. And so how do I write it rigorously in the language of triangles? I write it as follows. So if this is a complex, then there exists a filtration. Although it's not really a filtration, but it's a sequence of triangles. And this you have to think very similar to what we saw in the Arrhenius filtration. Somehow just that the quotients are not anymore quotients, but are triangles. OK, so the sequence is the following, 0, C0, mapping to C1, mapping to Cm minus 1, mapping to Cm, which is our C. And the triangles are the following. This guy goes into Am, and the triangle is here. And so what are these guys? These guys are element in your abelian category shifted by something. And so Ai is nothing but a cohomology in degree, oh wow, this is the convention, I'm sorry about it, minus Ki of my complex C shifted by Ki. And the condition I have is that K1 is greater than Km. So it seems bad what I did. I just wrote it as an extension by using the so-called stupid filtration in its cohomology objects. Okay, so that's the only thing I did. And the condition that some of the cohomologies are filtered in a certain way, these are cohomology Xi object, as before. I ask its condition, which is K1 greater than Km. So this is very similar to Arrhenius filtration. And that's the way we have to think about it. Okay, that's it. So that's about abelian categories, about derived categories. And now we come to the main definition of the that we're going to use next time. But first, let me remind you one thing, that somehow if your abelian category is a category of coherent sheaves, then all functors that you can define, they become derived functors. So they extend to the derived category. And when you take cohomology, they give you back the usual derived functors. OK, so that's a classical. OK, so sure. Yeah, that's correct. Yeah, the Ki is where the cohomology of C is. That's correct. So for example, if you have an object in A, there is just one cohomology in degree zero. If you have a complex consisting of two objects, the cohomology are just, and this is a morphism, it's just a co-kernel and the kernel shifted by one. Mm-hmm. Okay, so those are the two cohomology. Yeah. That's correct, thanks. Mm-hmm. Okay. Good. Now next. So I have A inside DBA, the last 3 minutes. So I have the following properties. So the X are the same as the HOMs. Exact sequences are the same as triangles all in A. And every object can be filtered in its cohomology sheaves. And so that's what I want as the definition. And so that's the main definition. Oops. The main definition of today. So now let me start with, so this is section 7, so hearts bounded these structures, and then we are done. And then that's it then. So I start with coherent sheaves, so I start with the X variety, as before, smooth projective. And I'm looking at the category A as coherent sheaves. And I do dbx, and now we know what it is. It's just a bounded category of coherent sheaves on X. OK. Now, definition. I say that an additive subcategory is a heart of a bounded D structure if it does satisfy the property I just told you. So definition. So I say that the category A inside the dbx, which is additive. Additive means it's closed under direct sum, is the heart of a bounded T structure. I won't tell you what the T structure is, but I'll tell you what the heart is, in a case they are equivalent. If the following three property holds. So the first property is what I wrote you there with a slight little twist. So the HOMs in dbx between A and B. Actually, let me write it like this. K of 1, B of K2 are equal to 0 for all K1 greater than K2 and for all A and B in my category A. So I don't want that whole Holmes, somehow this is the same if you use the shift functor as the Holmes between A and B shifted by K2 minus K1. And this guy, of course, is a negative number. So what I don't want all the x to be equal. This is a bit too strong, but it's important later. But I just want the negative Holmes to be 0. OK, so that's one condition, and which is very similar to coherent shift. The second condition is still written here. So the second condition is one I want that, but it's written there. This we're going to use it later. So the second condition is that that the same statement is true. So if I have a complex C in dBx, then there exists a filtration, as before, a sequence of triangles, exactly as before, so 0 equal to C0 goes into C1, goes into Cm minus 1, goes into Cm, which is our complex C, and the triangles are as before. With the property that you have, this is the shift by 1, and with the property that AI, it's belongs to A shifted by KI. And K1 is greater than KM. OK? So that's the statement. Sorry, just take one more second just to write the statement of what we want. OK, so that's definition. So it's something which has no negative Holmes. It has direct sums. And every complex splits as extension of cohomologies. And so example, by what we saw now, is actually we saw stronger. So example, if I look at coherent shifts inside dBx is a Hart. OK, so that's what we just said. I didn't prove it, but anyway. And the proposition is the following, is that if A is a Hart, then it's abelian. And one line of proof. The only thing I have to tell you is what are the exact sequences. But those were the ones written here. So exact sequences are triangles with vertices in A. Okay, and then you check all the properties by just using the definition. Okay, so that's a Hart. Okay, I'm done. The only thing I want to say is the following. So what we do now, the trick is the following. We start with coherent shifts, which does not work for defining stability. We embed it here, as I told before. And now what we do, we'll do some operation. There is only one operation you can do, which is called tilting. And we get a new category, which is going to be a Hart. And the property is that this Hart will have a stability condition on it for surfaces. Okay. And then we'll see what this abstract machinery can be used to apply to some concrete geometric question. Okay, yeah, thanks.